Alaska's experiencing a money boom. Cash generated by Alaskan oil is expected to produce tens of billions of dollars in excess of predicted state government expenditures. There is already $1.5 billion in the state coffers. This puts Alaska in the enviable position of deciding how to spend all this money, and there's no shortage of ideas.
$1.5 billion surplus? I think there's a lot of hungry people out here on the street that might need it.
Improving the roads around here.
I think we should save some of it and give some of it back to the people.
I'd like to see it given back to the taxpayers.
Move the capital. Move the capital.
Certain projects like renewable energy resources, exploration of outer space.
I think it could help some of the older people that have been up here for years.
I think they should look ahead to the future when the oil runs out, and that they should plan very carefully and not let it get frittered away on small programs with little lasting value.
Save it. Not spend it. Keep it.
Buying a football team, which might be an interesting thing, a dome stadium here in Anchorage.
I'd like to see some of it put into the mortgage home loans.
Substantial portion of it ought to go into the permanent fund to fund things in the future.
The rest of the money for the native land claims settlement, to get that out of the way and put a little boost in the economy.
It doesn't matter what they're going to spend it on, they're going to find something.
Hell, there's a lot of different ways.
There are a lot of different ways to spend Alaska's oil money, and determining the best use of our newfound wealth is what decision makers are currently grappling with. Governor Hammond, what do you think the state should do with its oil money surplus?
Well, I think we should invest it very carefully. That doesn't mean in simply economic development projects of the future, but we have some programs and needs of the moment that we should invest in. I've mentioned, for example, such things as education, some of the other constitutionally obligated charges that the state should perform. But I think the surplus is what you're really talking about, that above and beyond what we need for day-to-day operational expenses and that investment in the present. And my view is that the bulk of that, aside from what's needed for rainy days, contingencies, and what have you, should go into the permanent fund. You've got to remove the money, put it behind a rope where you cannot utilize it for flamboyant expenditures. That's why government grows so fantastically, and why the public, as I say, have bought so much of it. We sold it to them too cheaply.
Government has grown enormously, but who pays the bill? In 1969, the state budget was $294 million. The cost in 1980, $1.72 billion. This parallels Alaska's increased revenues from oil production. In 1969, total state income from oil amounted to $35 million. In 1980, it jumped to a staggering $2.25 billion. Oil money in 1980 pays 87% of the state budget. This is a phenomenal increase when compared to the 12% it contributed in 1969. Meanwhile, the percentage of the state's budget supported by personal income taxes has dropped from 8.5% in 1969 to 7% in 1980. This man, Representative Dick Randolph, says we shouldn't pay state income tax at all.
Well, I think the major problem we have in the state of Alaska is that the government has too much money and the people have too little. We've gotten to the position in the state where we equate big government budgets with prosperity. And that's not true. We have a situation in this state right now where the government's got literally billions of surplus dollars sitting in the treasury. And the people in Fairbanks and Palmer and Anchorage and all across the state haven't got enough money to pay their fuel bills or buy their groceries or make their house payments. The income tax repeal ought to be the first thing we do, and then take a look at where we are and decide what else we can afford to do.
He thinks that first you clear the boards as far as the taxpayer is concerned and eliminate any tax obligation. Well, I think, again, I'm much more concerned with the individual who has paid taxes for a number of years in Alaska getting a greater benefit.
I would divide the amount of resource income we have by the amount of Alaskans in the state and give everybody a check.
One of every four Alaskan taxpayers is an outsider. It's the only means we have of charging them, you might say, the price of admission to come up here and engage in our fisheries and work on our pipelines and deprive an Alaskan of a job. I think we ought to think twice before we eliminate that.
If we didn't have a state income tax today, if it wasn't on the books, would anybody, including the governor, seriously be proposing that we enact a state income tax today in our present economic situation? I think the answer is very clearly no.
if you went to the public and were obliged to say, look, do you want the program enough to let me take another tax dollar from you, then you sit on government growth. And wait a minute, forget it. But as long as it isn't perceived as their dollars providing for that government, and that's another one of my concerns for elimination of the income tax. That's the one connector between the citizen and the government is, don't you spend my tax dollars on that program.
What's going to happen when the oil money runs out then?
I don't really know. I think that'll be when the oil money runs out, when fossil energy money for this state runs out, I'll be long gone.
What'll happen? Chaos. About 1990? Who knows? Depends. You find another big Prudhoe Bay, and it will delay a few years from the time we'll go bankrupt. But all projections show that unless we do that, somewhere out in the future, you're going to go bankrupt.
I don't think oil money's going to run out for decades, 100 years, maybe longer. I'm absolutely convinced that as long as there's a market for fossil fuel, Alaska will be in the forefront of providing that need. And therefore, we don't need the very restrictive, retrogressive policies of the present administration.
I don't think Alaska is going to run out of oil and gas. I'm very optimistic about it. All we got to do is look for it. We may run out of, those things that would inspire us to go look because of pessimistic attitudes and preservationists and so forth. But I think there are enough Alaskans that we're going to make this thing happen. And I think it's going to go on forever.
Robert Hartig is a member of Commonwealth North, an organization confident Alaska's oil potential surpasses government estimates. The state is taking a more cautious look at the future. State geologist Ross Schaff.
So I'm very reluctant to assign a number to any one of the basins in the state of Alaska except where we have proven reserves. That's what we know. The rest is a matter of conjecture. When we're talking about reserves, we're talking about something that we know something about. These are facts. When we're talking about resources, then we're into the range of speculation.
Well, first you have to recognize that not all the information is made available to the government. Obviously, for competitive reasons, the industry isn't going to report their most favorable areas of exploration and so forth. We say that the oil potential is in excess of 100 billion barrels. I think the USGS is something like 22 to 58 billion barrels. The state of Alaska is something like 60 to 138 billion barrels. So we say in excess of 100 billion, but I think there are many of us who believe it's going to be in excess of 300 billion barrels. So that's quite optimistic.
The bottom line is that that you have only one way of determining what the oil and gas potential of the state of Alaska is, and that is to do detailed exploration. You've got to drill for oil in order to determine that oil is there.
The ability to drill in all of Alaska's suspected resource areas is severely limited by the National Lands Withdrawal Question. So Alaska's looking at developing its renewable resources for when the oil runs out. Later we will look at oil that has run out. In this case, it ran out of the freighter Li Wang Xin and into Alaska's waters. With government taking a less optimistic view of Alaska's oil resources than industry is, a gloomy forecast of Alaska's long-term financial stability has led to the Permanent Fund. Many don't see an end to Alaska's wealth, but there are people making plans for that time the governor called chaos. Decisions that are made in the near future will chart the course for the next 20 years in Alaska. Should the money be used to stimulate the current poor economy, or distributed as a bonus to Alaska citizens? Should it be tucked away and saved for future generations, or should it be used to develop our renewable resources? There are no easy answers. The Alaska Growth Policy Council is taking a hard look at these questions and are listening to a variety of viewpoints.
We need to develop the non-petroleum activities of this state, and we must use the wealth that we have today and tomorrow to make sure that we have the wherewithal for our children.
What are those non-petroleum resources? They are the renewable ones that Alaska has traditionally relied on. Will they ever fill the gap left by oil money? And how can their prospects be improved by government? The timber industry exports nearly all of its forest products to Japan, and the demand remains high. Don Bell, head of the Alaska Loggers Association, makes this suggestion to increase productivity.
It would be less government regulation of the whole industry. It seems like everything that we do timber harvest-wise, there's some agency there saying you can't do this and you can't do that. So many of these restrictions for environmental reasons, at least in my opinion, don't make sense.
Mining brought the first boom to Alaska, but has dwindled to new lows. With identified coal deposits and world gold prices soaring, this could rejuvenate the industry. But Governor Hammond points out a significant fact.
You know what our severance tax on gold is? Nothing. What our severance tax on coal? Nothing. Can you imagine a situation where the people would permit that to occur with oil? On the presumption it's creating jobs and all sorts of business activity, we demand, it, as we did, that it pay a significant severance tax to the citizens of the state. I think it's imperative that we at least recognize that none of these other hard rock minerals or coal will be paying anything at all, virtually.
While agriculture is still in its infancy, many have high hopes for its future. The state is committed to its success. Speaker of the House, Terry Gardiner.
We're also going to be pushing several specific economic development projects that are of some larger scale. One of these will be the Delta Barley Project. We, for 2 years now, appropriated about $8 million each year for the development of the Delta Barley Project. It is well on the line, and they are producing barley up there and moving into the areas of developing their markets, and we're going to continue support for that. Also, we're going to support the development of the Point McKenzie Agricultural Project, which is a dairy farm project. And this is a very good project, both from a development standpoint and also for the fact that it creates a product, milk, which can actually be marketed in Alaska.
Alaska's second most profitable resource is fishing. In 1979, the wholesale value from our fisheries reached an amazing $1.9 billion. But in a yet unreleased report from the state's Division of Economic Enterprise, there is an indication that the future situation for marketing of Alaska seafood products is anything but good. Inventories of salmon in Washington and Oregon and Alaska are reported to be very large. The 1980 harvest is expected to be a very good one, and the prices for Alaska seafood products are weakening in Japan, our biggest customer. Consequently, Alaska may face a fish glut. Bottom fishing, an undeveloped industry in Alaska, is another story. Jim Edenso.
We think it's potentially a multi-billion dollar industry, which in the future could provide as much as 20,000 to 30,000 new employment opportunities for fishermen and for laborers in the state. And that would be over a 20-year period of time.
How much will it cost to develop this industry?
Well, there are many, many estimates that are around, and some of those estimates include anywhere from $500 million to, I've heard, estimates that go in excess of $2.5 billion. Indeed, if you were to take the federal government report, just for the vessels they recommend alone, you're talking about $1.7 to $2 billion in capital investments for vessels only. And you can see that, you know, there's a wide divergence in which one is right. And I can only say that in the end it'll be very expensive. However, the returns are very great.
We have seen a number of renewable resources that will make us less dependent on oil in the future. Fishing shows great promise, but ironically, it could be threatened by the very thing it may replace. Bunker C on the rocks.